Hi, my name is Emma Katire, and I'm a system strategist. And in today's video, I'm going to take you through the onboarding Zap that I use in my business with my clients. So Zapier, if you're not familiar, is a software that connects applications together. So applications that aren't natively connected. So for instance, Zoom, you can integrate it with Dubsado directly, but something like ConvertKit, you can't. So what you can do with Zapier is that if a certain trigger happens in Dubsado or another software, you can have it perform an action in another software. So in this case, like once a contract is signed in Dubsado, it does a list of tasks for me in different applications to save me time. And then once it's set up correctly, then I don't have to worry about things, you know, making mistakes or anything like that. It just takes care of this long list of tasks for me. Just so you're aware, Zapier does have a free version, but that free version will only do single step Zap. So if A happens in this application, do B in this other application. You can't do multi-steps. You can't do filters or anything like that. So once I reached a stage in my business where I was booking clients consistently, it became important for me to save time and to make sure that things were done correctly. So once this app was set up once and it was okay, then I didn't have to worry about making mistakes down the road. So let's get started and I'll take you through this app. So the first step is contract signed. So in Dubsado, once it detects that a contract is signed, it will continue. Next, I want to do a filter. I don't want this app to run for every type of contract that I have. So I have a filter set up. If it senses the word Dubsado setup in the title of the contract, it will continue. Otherwise, it pauses. That's it. Okay, won't do the rest of the tasks. So I can set up this app for different types of contracts so that it does what I need for each service that I offer. Next, I want it to format the date and time. So if you look, the project start date that it's picking up from the contract in Dubsado has what I can only assume is a timestamp attached to it. So I want to format it like this, to year, month, and day, nothing else, so that I can use that on my project folders. So it just formats it, it turns it into this, and it continues. The next step, I want it to create a project folder for me in Google Drive. So I use Google Drive with my clients. I don't use Dubsado's client portal because I want clients to be able to upload things into different folders, edit some Google Docs that I have in there. So I use this app to set all of that up for me. So it creates a folder that's the event you want to use. And the action you want to take is find the parent folder that you want to use in your Google Drive and then put the folder name here. So the folder name is dynamic. It uses the client's name and last name from the contract. So you can see step one and then Dubsado setup that's fixed. And then this a project date that is basically the formatted project start date from Dubsado. So that comes from step three, the formatter. And then I add that there and done. Next, I want to add the file sharing preferences to make sure that my clients can edit the files in that folder and to upload things into those folders for me. So the action is file ID. So what you're going to do is search through these steps here and then find the file ID. That means that every time it creates this new project folder, it's going to grab the file ID of that new folder so that it's always editing or changing the file sharing of the right folder. And then here you have a long list of options. The one at the very bottom, specify an email address, didn't used to exist. It's new as far as I can tell. So for the longest time, I was using this one. Anyone on the internet who has a link can edit. If you don't feel comfortable with that, you can use this one. Just know that it is going to send a notification to your client. I'm pretty sure you can edit that in Google Drive. I haven't done that, but that's the reason I don't use that because it would notify my client before I want it to. So I've just left it the way that I had it for a long time before this option was available, but this is available to you. So you can specify an email and select the email from the step one. Next, it creates subfolders for me. So the parent folder is no longer your parent folder in Google Drive. It's the ID of the folder it created in step four. Okay, so you're going to select that here. You're going to go here and select that. In this case, it's a fixed folder. The subfolders are fixed for me. You can make them dynamic using your, you know, client's name if you want to from step one. So you just have to select that. Like here, you would have to add these two to the title, whatever you want, but I just have them fixed at the subfolder level. These next steps create more subfolders for me. And here in step 9, what I want it to do is to find a Google Doc that I have in my Google Drive. And then in step 10, I want to create a copy of that. So it's kind of like I have a template in my Google Drive, and then I want it to create a copy of that template for this particular client. So when you create Zaps, you kind of have to break stuff down into very small steps. When I first started using Zapier, I was a bit confused. I thought these should have been one step, but it's just you have to break it down into minute steps. So find a file. It's going to find a file with this name inside of this folder in my Google Drive, and it's going to look for Google Docs specifically. Once it finds it, then it's going to, this is the file it found, number 9 over here in step 9. And then it's going to create a copy and it's going to title it this. Okay, so here I did use the client's name from step 1, and it's just client process and name of the client. The next steps are the same thing, finding files, creating copies, all that sort of stuff. So I'm going to skip ahead. Here it's going to create a label for me inside of Gmail. So what I want is to create label or like a subfolder inside of Gmail with a client's name so I can pour all my emails into that folder. What you can do here is you can see the syntax says parent slash child. So the parent folder in this case is not the main, is not at the top level. I want it to go under this parent folder called clients. Okay, so I type that in. If you have a parent folder you want it to go into, type it in and then put the name of the folder that you want to create. So in this case, it's dynamic. I want it to be the client's name. Next, I want Zapier to send me an email with a link to all of the folders and files that it created for me so that I don't have to go into Google Drive and copy paste them to share them with my client. Okay, so here is like the subject of the email. So it's Google Drive links for my client's name. Make sure you do that so you're not confused, like, because you might have several coming in, different clients. So just use the identifier of the client's name. And so here is the body of the email. So I just put hi, project folders, and then I start putting those in. So you can see this option of insert data becomes available, and you can pull from any of the steps that you have above, right? So if I wanted to send the main project folder link, you just have to scroll down here and find what you see up here. It's called alternate link. As you scroll through the options available, you're going to see a lot of different links. The alternate link is the one that your client can access. Don't ask me why it's called alternate link, but I've figured out by trying a lot of them that this is the one that works. So I have it for all these different folders that I created or documents. So Zapier sends me an email with all of these links, and then I copy and paste them into custom map fields in Dubsado. I still can't automate that part of adding custom map fields, but I just do it once and then it's done. Next, it adds my new client's information to a table in Airtable. So Airtable, I have a database that has several sheets or tables in it. And each one is for leads, one is for clients. I have like payments, reviews, and other things. So what it does is that it adds this new client to my client table. So it looks for the table, it searches for the client's name. If it doesn't find them, it creates a record, right? So it creates a record with the client's name, what they signed up for, the date they signed up, their project start date, all of these things that are important to me. Next, it finds the client in my lead table because I want it to update that client from, like, you know, discovery call booked to booked, actually. So what it does in this case is that it goes into my lead tracking. It searches by email. It searches for the email. The email should be here. And then it searches for an exact match. Once it finds the client, so it finds the client here in this step. Okay, so that's the record that it found. Then it's going to update them to this status. This is a status that I have from a drop-down list, so I have to make it match exactly, and then it'll show up correctly, right, with the right colors and everything that I have set up in Airtable. So it's now it shows them as a lead that was booked, and it also added them to my client database. So the next step is to create a task in Google Tasks. I don't use project management software like ClickUp or anything like that. I think I used Microsoft Project for too long in my corporate days, and I really don't enjoy using that type of software unless I have to. I use Asana for some things in my business once I start a project to make sure that I'm going through all the tasks. But for my day-to-day, like marketing and like that sort of stuff, I don't use project management software. So what it does is that in my Google Tasks, it finds a task list called testimonials, and it puts the name of the client in review. So why I do this is because Dubsado sends them a feedback form and follows up with them. But just in case they don't follow through, they don't submit a review during that time period. So I have this there so that I can make sure that I track it. And if I need to do a manual follow-up, I will. I have a separate Zap so that when they do submit a review, this gets checked off. Next, it creates events in my Google Calendar to block off time for this project. So what it does is it creates an event with a client's name, Dubsado Setup, on the start date, so from 8:30 to noon on the start date of the project, and it repeats 5 times. So Monday through Friday, I have a time block from 8:30 to 12:30 that is marked as busy. And the idea here is I need this so that I can focus, so that I don't have other calls during that time, so that I can have some focus time to work on the setup, okay? I've done a lot of stuff before, but this is the point where I go into someone's account and I build everything out for them. Next, it uses the email that my client signed up with, and it searches for them in ConvertKit. So it looks for them. Well, if that email that it's looking for matches an email in ConvertKit, it adds a tag of client to that email so that my client doesn't get, you know, promotional emails for Dubsado setups. They've already done one. I don't want them to get those types of emails. Okay. So this is my onboarding Zap. You can see it has a lot of steps. And I calculate that it saves me about 20-something minutes per client, maybe more. It's also like a load off my mind. I don't have to worry. I know it's all taken care of, which is really nice. And like I said, I didn't start with this in my business. Once I got to a certain point, I felt like it was important to start doing this. And if you're interested in learning more about what Zapier can do for you, Dubsado recently did a webinar with Todd Harper, who's a certified Dubsado specialist and a Zapier expert. And that webinar really expanded my idea of what Zapier can do. It also really helped me. There were some Zaps that I was stuck on that I couldn't figure out. And after that webinar, I was able to set them up, like a Zap to send text messages to clients before calls. And this Zap, this step here, Formatter by Zapier, the formatting the date, that came after I watched that webinar, because it didn't occur to me really that I could do that. So thanks to Todd, I edited this Zap. I changed other Zaps that I have. I created Zaps like digest Zaps based on his webinar. So if you're interested in learning more about what Zapier can do, definitely go check that out. It's a really, really good webinar. So I hope this was helpful, and I will see you next.